You're going to have to declare in your family and decree in your family. I think Joshua said it best. And then, as for me and my house, we will. So there is Ezra's proclamation. As a pastor of this church, I proclaim a fast for 21 days. Not that you can just be off a diet, Dr. Peppers, or whatever food you like, but that you and I may have a closer relationship with God that will not only be from those 21 days, but will go on for the rest of our lives. That we will give up something for the Lord. Ezra says, I proclaim the fast so that we might, watch this text, that we might, King James says, might afflict ourselves. But this translation says that we might humble ourselves. So he says, literally he's saying, he's not only giving to us Ezra's proclamation, but also Ezra's submission. Because the word afflict means to humble in this text. It means to submit. Because before God can bless us, before God can do a greater work in us, we have to submit ourselves. We have to humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God. Because he who exalts himself shall be made abased. But he who humbles himself, the Bible says, shall be exalted. Can I get a witness in here? And Ezra says, humble ourselves. Many of us don't want to humble ourselves. That's why we can't be blessed. Some of us too proud to admit our shortcomings. Too many of us too proud to admit that we don't have all answers. You know, some of us think we know it all. But I came to serve us notice that don't no one person know it all. Can I get a witness in here? And if you're going to be blessed by the Lord, you notice throughout the scriptures, throughout all the narratives, that if a person was going to be blessed, they had to humble themselves and submit themselves. That word submit literally means to line up under. Not line up beside, but line up under the person who has authority over you. And he's saying we got to line up under, submit under, humble ourselves under God's will in our life. That means that you and I can't sit on the throne any longer. We got to get off our thrones and get off our high horses and come down and make sure that we know that God is in control, that God is running things. Ezra had submission. Hear the text, verse 21, I not only see Ezra's submission, but as you read further in the text, look at what his humble heart made him to say. He says, humble ourselves before our God, and watch this, and ask him. And note it, he didn't put ask before he said humble. What you asking for? See, a person who think they got it all, they ain't gonna ask them. See, some of us, until you admit that you need God, God's not going to push his way in. But we have to humble ourselves to say, God, I can't do this anymore. I've been trying to do this on my own. I've been trying to shake these chains on my own. I've been trying to break the strongholds on my own. I've been trying this program and that program. But God, they are not working. God says, humble yourself. And the text says, after they humble themselves, he says, and ask him for a safe journey. Now notice he says, ask, which means to seek. The Bible says, ask, and it shall be given. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and the door shall be open unto you. That we all we got to do is ask God for. Isn't that something? All you got to do is ask. And if God feels like you can handle it, if God feels like you need it, I'm a living witness that God will grant to you what you need. Can I get a witness in here? Notice what Ezra asked for. He asked God for a safe journey. And since he's saying, we need your protection. We need you, God, to walk alongside us. If he were not sit you, he'd probably say, Lord, walk with me, Lord. Walk with me, Lord. While I'm on this tedious journey, walk with me, Lord. What a great leader he was. He prayed and asked God for safety. And notice the text says, he says, for us and our children. He didn't say for me and mine. And that's what prayer and fasting will do. Prayer and fasting will lead you away from selfishness. And it will lead you to be concerned about more than just yourself, but concerned about others. And all I'm going to tell you, brothers and sisters, don't be just concerned about me, myself, and I. Be concerned about somebody else. And many times I found out when you bless others. That's the way of God coming back, bringing something in your life. Can I get a witness in here? If you ever had a chance to go feed somebody who's homeless and all their pillow is the concrete and all their cover is the sky, then you will understand. But if you ever had to feed somebody else, then you have a right to say, Lord, I thank you. I may not have much, but what I have, God, I thank you for it. I may not have a lot of clothes, but what I have, God, I thank you. I may not have a lot of money in the bank, but God, I can meet all my bills. Can I get a witness in here? And here he says, Lord, make us a safe journey. For me, our children, our possessions. He said, here's the reason why. He did not ask. Because when you read Nehemiah, Nehemiah went to the king, and he asked the king, but Nehemiah was coming from a political point of view, because he had a political office, so he had to ask from a political point of view, the king, we need your help in this, and God granted him favor. But here, Ezra is talking from a spiritual point of view, as a spiritual leader. He's saying, we're not going to turn to the king and ask him nothing, because we already told him. That's right here in the Bible. We already told you that God's hand is a gracious hand. And that our God can supply whatever we need. So I love it about Brother Ezra, that Ezra cared more for God's reputation than his own safety. See, God hadn't brought him by yet, but he believed that God would. And I think I got about 10 witnesses in here who can testify that there have been times in your life when you didn't know how you were going to make it, but you trusted God and you believed God would open the door. Can I get a witness in here? And Ezra says, I didn't ask the king because God's reputation was at stake. Sounded kind of like those Hebrew boys when they were in the fiery furnace. And they told the king that if God decides not to deliver us out of the furnace, we know that God is able and we will not bow down. Can I get a witness in here? Ezra said to the Lord, we will not ask the king for anything, but God is a gracious God. And God will take care of his children. I heard Paul say, say to Paul. Paul said he had a thorn. He asked the Lord three times, if you will, Lord, remove this thorn. And the Lord said, my grace mission. And my strength is made perfect in your weakness. Can I get a witness in here? So right and the same, God has a reputation. And God has a track record. If God said he would do something, you can put this in the bank and know that God will do what he said. Brothers and sisters, let's not hold you too long. The last verse in our text for the morning says, verse 23 says, so we fasted and we petitioned our God. And we petitioned him about this. Because I gotta ask God for what I want. I can be specific in asking God for what I need. And he said, we fasted and petitioned our God about this very thing. And the Bible says God answered our prayer. Tell you that Ezra had a declaration, and it was that God will answer your prayer. Is there anybody in the room this morning who can testify that God can answer your prayer? Can I get a witness in here? In the Bible it says there were no shortcuts when Moses and the children of Israel went through the Red Sea. Bible will teach you there were no shortcuts when Noah built the altar. The Bible said, and the Bible will teach you that there were shortcut when David slew Goliath. The Bible will teach you that there were no shortcuts when Daniel was in the lion's den. And the Bible will teach you now that there were no shortcuts when the three Hebrew boys were in the fiery furnace. The Bible will teach you that there were no shortcuts when Jesus went through the town of Samaria. Can I get a witness in here? The Bible will teach you that there were no shortcuts when the woman who had the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment. Can I get a witness? And the Bible will teach you that there were no shortcuts when Jesus went toward Calvary. The Bible will teach you that Jesus made a request to his heavenly Father and said, Lord, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And hung on an old rugged cross. And the Bible comes to the kingdom of God. What do you mean, Pastor? Jesus said it like this. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. You can't take a shortcut and go on the way. What God's calling has been on our lives, but you can't take no shortcuts. You got to come in at the door. You got to go His way. You got to follow His plan. And God has a plan for our lives. But there are no shortcuts to His plan. You can't put it in the microwave and think it's going to heat up for you fast. You can't do that. There are no shortcuts. You have to go according to His plan. And however God said, that's what we got to do. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all thy heart and lean not to thine own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall down only Him. We've been trying to go the shortcut. Find an easier route to do what God says to do. But you got to do what God says and do it how He says it. There's no other way but His way. Only God's way. Only His way. Only His way. If you're here today, we're going to extend the privilege. For someone today, why?